So that's going to be happening tomorrow. Then we'll be able to finish sheetrock and getting everything finished with that. Very, very excited about how fast that's coming along. I just want to say thanks again to everybody that's involved with getting our construction done. This coming Wednesday, we're going to be serving food at the BCM at Carl Albert. I think we've got enough food and help lined up, but if you want to go and assist me with making jokes and keeping everybody cracked up while we're going through the line, feel free to come along and do that with me. We'll have a good time, I promise. That's going to be this Wednesday, 12 o'clock at Carl Albert. Let's see. All right, we're going to have the fifth Sunday this month. That means that we kind of like to, we're going to do a little round robin singing. Please get with JB. He is the band leader of that. So if you would like to participate and bring any type of special music that you want to, please let him know and get with him on that. Let's see, we're going to be having a business meeting today right after church. We haven't had one in a couple of months. We do have some important things to go over. So if you're interested in how the church works, that would be a good time for you to see how that goes, because we talk very specific things like money, bank accounts and things like that, things that we wouldn't normally talk about in this type of setting. But it is not a secret meeting. You don't have to be a member to attend the meeting, but you do have to be a member to vote and have voting privileges and have input and things like that. That's just the way that it is. So with that being said, several of you have been visiting with me for the past couple of months about church membership. We will be adding your name to the roll books today. We're also going to be removing some people that have departed that we just need to officially remove. So we're just going to be taking care of business today. So as always, I'm going to try not to take up as much of your time as possible, because your time is very, very important and I respect you. But we do have some very important things to take care of. So if you can, meet me back in here just as soon as church is over and we'll get on with it. All right. We gave away about 60 crosses last week. It was awesome. 60 crosses from our church in two songs. Makes us very happy. You guys got anything real quick? All right. Jenna wants to share 5 minutes of grace today, so we'll let her do that. You guys come on up. That'll keep her short. She gets long-winded sometimes. So get on up here. Come on. Let's have some prayer while all these are getting ready. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for today. Thank you for this opportunity to be together and worship. Thank you for this beautiful place that we have. All the beautiful souls that make it up. Father, we just want to learn more about you, because whenever we learn more about you, we learn more about ourselves. We learn how this beautiful relationship that you set up, we learn how it works. And we learn how to operate efficiently in that relationship. So God, we just want to thank you for your never-ending grace. Thank you for this love that you have proved to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's his name we pray. Amen. Amen.
So, again, my name is Jenna, and I'm a great believer in Jesus Christ. And I came to celebrate Recovery Catholic Church in active addiction. And I'm a part of that group because I came here for drug and alcohol addiction. So I shared several months back a 5 minutes of grace about my daughter and how when I was 16 when I had my oldest daughter. And when she turned 16, I was in my active addiction. And like it, this overwhelming feeling just hit me when she turned 16 and how if she were to have been pregnant, what kind of a grandma I would be at that time. Because I remember like my grandmas when I was growing up and they were awesome. And I just, everything that I was doing, like it just, this overwhelming feeling just hit me one day. And I was just like, what kind of a grandma would I be? And so I know that God heard that in my heart. It's not like I hit my knees at that time. I didn't pray. I didn't cry out. But I know that God heard me. Heard my heart. And because when she was about 3 months pregnant, you know, he brought that back to my mind. He was like, you know, he just let me know. He spoke to me and said, I did that for you. You're going to be a grandma and you're going to be a great one. And which was amazing. And I just wanted to share, like, how much he cares about you individually. What he did was, so my daughter tried to be induced, and her 40-week appointment, as they went by, you know, with her on her ultrasounds and all that, was she was due the 31st, so they tried to induce her, I think it was like the fifth. So, and that didn't work. They tried to induce her for 5 days. Well, he brought my grandbaby into the world on April 11th, and April 11th was the day that I walked out of Chihuahua in 2019. So he brought my grandbaby into the world the day that I walked out of Chihuahua, a changed person, you know. And so it's just little things like that that God cares about you individually, and that day it'll mean something to me for the rest of my life, April 11th, because he cared. He cared when I was no good, I was doing no good. He cared that I cared to be a good grandma, and he heard that. And these little things that he's done for me, that's how much he cares. He cares about each one of y'all like that. So I have a grandbaby the day I left rehab, a changed person.
Thank you. He's a chain breaker.
I was listening to a Bible study, and the lady was just talking about Paul and how he was in prison, and most of his letters that he wrote came from while he was in prison. Even though he was pretty much in chains, he was real down low and in prison, he was still able to get the gospel out and share the gospel, and that's what we have today in the New Testament.
There I was, empty-handed, crying out the pit of my despair. And there you were, in the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there.
Yeah.
And now
sing that again. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you.
To love like you have loved me.
Big institutions have lost our trust. Unfortunately, the church, the Christian church in America, is just about being condemned like that. We find ourselves in the series that we're doing right now. It's called the Torchbearer Series, and it's very important to me because we have to learn God's Word correctly, in the correct context, and in the love that it was given from the Father's heart, knowing the intention of the Father's heart, that Jesus Christ was put out into the world to pay the price for our sins and that people would be drawn to the church. As you look around amongst yourselves every Sunday, you see that society as a whole is just not being drawn to the church. Nobody is coming behind us to save us. Nobody is coming behind to carry on the church. This is our responsibility to teach our children and our community the correct way to love people, and so that people will be drawn to the church. We have been given authority to do that. The blood of Jesus Christ was given to the church. You and I are the church. We are the ones that have been commissioned. We have the sacred word. From the time of Jesus' death, we have everything in this new covenant, 2,000 years, we have the sacred word on our side. I'm very thankful that we still have that. There may be a time in yours and mine's lifetime that we don't have open and easy access to it like we do now. How does that strike you? We have to have this word in our heart. We have to have this word put into our children's heart, our community's heart. I cannot stress to you how important that the times are that we're in right now. We have to take this thing very, very serious. We just have to. It's our responsibility. So we find ourselves today, I wanted to visit with you a little bit about, as we study and try to learn God's Word correctly, I want to spend some time talking about the Trinity, but more importantly, I want to spend some time talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is very misunderstood. Lots of misconceptions about the Holy Spirit. Some people are scared to death of it. Some people abuse its power. Where we are, we have to find the middle ground, and the middle ground is what God's Word says. We have to take man's influence out of it. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, we find Paul closing out that book with a very specific prayer. And three things that he touches on right there. Talks about God the Father, the Holy Spirit, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This forms what's called the Holy Trinity. Now, that word is not found in Scripture. The word Trinity is just not there, just like the word rapture. It's not ever going to be found in the Bible as you go about your Bible studies. But the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is mentioned very specifically several times, and it's not my job, it's not my goal today to cover all of those things with you, but I want you to see what Paul is talking about as we have this love and we have this, just this relationship with the Trinity. Now, you can have a relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ, and not knowing that you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. This is how misunderstood it is sometimes. We have had an interaction with the Holy Spirit in order for us to be a believer. And this might not be something that you can, that you'd be able to rationalize or be able to put into words, but it has happened. But I want to look at what Paul says right here, talk about these three aspects of the Holy Spirit, and jump down into it, we'll get to it. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is something that I love that, because you guys know, if you've been here more than once, we believe in the totality of the grace of Jesus Christ. This new covenant that we are operating under is new. It's good and it's better than the old covenant. And so we honor it. So the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, I'm going to cover these two things with you very briefly, but we're going to get down into it, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. That was Paul's prayer to the church there at Corinth. So, the question is, as we start out, do we have those three things? I would say most of us in here at least has the first two down pretty darn good, but let's spend a little time checking into it. The love of the Father. We need to know the intentions of the Father, right? Whenever we know the intentions of the Father, it becomes very easy for us to see God's grace. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. We're just going to cover these things very quickly as we go through this. But God demonstrates His own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for us 2,000 years before we were here. He forgave us in advance. This is God's love put out there, everything on the line, put out there so that we could experience a oneness with Him. Jesus Christ, like you said, like we talked about last week on Easter, we talked about a separation that Jesus had to experience with the Father. There was a death. There was a spiritual death that Jesus had to die in order that we would be able to be physically linked with Him. The love of the Father. We cover this quite often, so that's all I'm going to spend on today. How about the grace of Jesus Christ? There's a very specific prayer that Jesus prayed in John chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. This is Jesus' prayer for believers. I think this is a very good way just to very quickly summarize the grace of Jesus Christ that He has for us. Now, this is Jesus in the garden praying before He gets arrested, before His time at the cross. And so there He is praying this prayer right here. He says, I do not pray for these alone. He's talking about His disciples. He just offered a prayer up for those, but also for those who will believe in Me through their word. So this prayer that we examine right here is the prayer that Jesus prayed to God for you and me. This prayer right here is why we're sitting here today. It says that they all may be one as You, Father, are in Me and I in You. That they may also be one in us, referring to the Trinity, that the world may believe that You sent Me. 22. And the glory which You gave Me, I have given them, that they may be one just as We are one. Again, referring to we, us, the Trinity. I in them, You in Me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that You have sent Me and have loved them as You have loved Me. Father, I desire that they also whom You gave Me may be with Me where I am, that they may behold My glory which You have given Me, for You loved Me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known You, but I have known You, and these have known that You sent Me. And I have declared to them Your name, and will declare that the love which You loved Me may be in them, And I am them. This prayer that Jesus offered up, this was God's idea. Did you ever think about your salvation? This was God's plan. This is God's idea. You know, we have this weird way of thinking about our salvation that it rests on us, that the responsibility of salvation is ours. You see, that's come from man over time, and that's really not how it's supposed to be. Whenever Jesus talks about us being in Him, refers back to another passage Jesus talked about, us being the branch, God being the root. Well, let's think a little bit about how branches and roots work. Right? You got a root, that's where all the nutrients come from, that's gathering up everything. The root is what the life giver is. It pushes all the nutrients up, the tree puts the branches out. The branches don't do anything but accept. The branches doesn't have any responsibility but just to grow because of what has been put into them. And so the branches can't all of a sudden one day go, oh man, I'm not doing a good enough job being a branch. I'm not growing like I'm supposed to be growing. Because that's impossible for it to work that way. And so whenever Jesus says that we are one in Him, we are receiving everything that we need from God. You understand that it was complete? Whenever Jesus died on the cross, He rose again. Jesus cried out. Whenever He was there, He said, it's finished. And He meant it's done. And it's good. And so your salvation was never your idea. So it's not your responsibility to maintain it. Our responsibility is to accept the love of Jesus Christ and understand that it is a gift. We accept that love. We accept that we have been made worthy of that love. And we accept it, and then we multiply it back out into the world. So this is what God was praying for you and I. Jesus planned for us to be with them together. Now, if we are in Jesus, Jesus is in God, can anybody explain to me a formula that you've been able to have been taught or that you maybe have come up with on your own on how we can get closer to God than Jesus and God Himself? It's impossible to do. So if we are one with Jesus, then we have everything that we need. Somehow or another, we've come up with this formula based on the closeness to God that we've been taught either directly or indirectly over the years, where we look back and we evaluate our past. Whenever we look back and evaluate that, we think about how good we've been or we think about how bad we've been. Now, we come up with different time stamps for us to be able to do that. Sometimes we look back a week, or sometimes we might just be looking back over the past day, but we kind of give ourselves this unofficial score on how good or bad we've been. And whenever we come up with that unofficial score, whether it's acceptable or unacceptable, then we kind of relate that to God, and we have this score, and if we think that we haven't been that good today, then that's how much permission we give ourselves to be close to God. We say that we probably haven't pleased Him as much as we should today, so we might feel like we're a little farther away from God. Maybe it's been a good day. Maybe we've had some good works. Maybe we've had an opportunity to serve somebody. Maybe we've been able to bless somebody, and we're proud of ourselves. And we go, man, I'm Christ-like today. And so we give ourselves to be really close to God at that time. But then the next day comes, and we've got to do it all over again. And it is a vicious cycle that has done nothing but frustrate believers for thousands of years now. So you have to understand that this was never your idea, so it's not your responsibility. It is our job to accept the love perfectly, the way that it was made and given to us, and we multiply that love and put it back out into the world. This whole thing is about love. You understand that, right? It is about God's love for us, Jesus' grace, and it is a very perfect love. 1 John chapter 4. You ever think about what the opposite of love is? It's not hate. According to this right here, it's the absence of love. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. But I'll tell you what, the Holy Spirit worked on me on this scripture today, because I think about the world, and I think about our future. And I've told you this before, and I still am. I'm scared of the future because I'm scared of what's coming. But I've had to understand that since I am a believer, since I am in Him, He's in me, the world's going to do some weird and crazy stuff. It's going to continue to be the world. The only influence I'm going to be able to have is our little community, our little family right here. I've got influence in that. But I've got everything that I need, no matter what happens, because I'm in Christ. So I've had to learn that I'm not scared of what the world's going to bring. I've had to come to accept that the world is going to just be the world. It's going to do some stuff that I don't agree with. It's going to do some stuff I wish I could change, some things I wish I could make better. But I've got to learn that I'm not to be scared anymore. Because if I'm scared, then the love of Christ is not working in me the way that it was meant to. So I've got to just take this love and understand that He's watching out for me. And understand that everything that happens is going to be for my good because I'm in Him. So with this perfect love that we have, moving on to the third thing that I wanted to make sure that you understand today, and this is what it's all about. Are you in communion with the Holy Spirit? So the Holy Spirit's had a lot of misconceptions over the years. The Holy Spirit gets blamed for a lot of things that it shouldn't be blamed for. Holy Spirit kind of gets accused of things. People think that they have to have some evidence of the Holy Spirit for people to be saved. Those people that believe in that will believe that I'm not saved because I don't speak in tongues. We don't have big healing services here, even though we believe in prayer. We believe that God is in control. We've seen lots of people healed from lots of different things, but I don't have a time where I make people line up. I punch them in the forehead. They go back, put $500 in the box back there, and they go home healed. We don't do that because that's abuse of the Holy Spirit. Feel free to drop some money in the box, but that's not what we're here about. And I'll punch you for free if that's what you come here for. I might like it. Communion with the Holy Spirit means that the Spirit lives in us. You see, in the Easter's past, I've talked about this and I've taught on it many times. Before Jesus went to the cross, the Holy Spirit lived in the tabernacle. The Holy Spirit was in the place that was called the Holy of Holies. It was a very special place. It was separated from the world with a purple cloth. Whenever Jesus died on the cross, the veil was ripped from the top down. And the Spirit of God was led out into the world. And so while I agree that the Holy Spirit used to live in a tabernacle, the Holy Spirit does not live in churches now. Does not live in any temple whatsoever. Right. Anybody was, y'all remember the joke I used to make over there at the old building? If God lived in churches, He would have left the old barn a long time ago. Because it was hot and it was really cold and it was dusty and there was no good reason for anybody to be there. So God would not have been there if God just wanted to live in churches. You see, the thing about it is, whenever the Spirit was let loose into the world, we become the tabernacle. We become the housing place. And so now the Holy Spirit lives in people. This is the same Spirit that came into Jesus whenever He was in the tomb and breathed life back into Him. The same Spirit that breathed life back into Jesus Christ is the Spirit that lives in believers. And so the Spirit works through you. The Spirit works in you. The Spirit will work in spite of you. Now, there's three things that I want to cover whenever it comes to talking about the Spirit right here. Now, the Scripture is just chock full of descriptions of the Holy Spirit. And somehow or another, we still seem to get it wrong sometimes. Have you heard the expression, the Holy Spirit showed up and showed out today? You haven't heard that here. Because it don't work like that. Because if you come in here and you're a believer, then the Holy Spirit was already here. We don't sing songs asking the Holy Spirit to come down and to fill this place and to bless us because it's asking Him to do something He's already done. We're not going to insult God by asking Him to do something that He took care of 2,000 years ago. is probably going to say, referred back to. Where are y'all at? See, we don't need to be asking God to keep doing the same thing over and over again that we already have. Whenever we do that, we're limiting our understanding and we're missing out on the goodness and the peace that God has already given us. And so my hope for you today is that you understand and you learn how to operate efficiently in what we already have. And I think I can show you how to do that. Three things we're going to touch on today. The Holy Spirit has been referred to as our helper. John chapter 14. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. Jesus' words again. But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things I said to you. The time that you got saved is because the Holy Spirit was working on you. You can't get saved without the Holy Spirit. Okay? And you can think that it's your idea or whatever, but it's not. It talks about in other places. John will talk on this a lot, so I didn't put it in here today. But the job of the Holy Spirit to the unbeliever is to convict the unbeliever of sin, the 613 laws. Once you've been convicted of that, you see that you're guilty of those laws. You see you've been guilty of letting God down in those 613 ways. And then you go, oh my gosh. There's nothing I can do about this myself to get it right, because I might be able to uphold 600 of them, but there's 13 of them that I can't get right. And if you like eating catfish or shrimp on Friday nights, then you're hopeless, because you can't even be able to do it. Because that's a law. And so the Holy Spirit comes in and convicts you of this sin, and you see that, man, I'm messed up because of this, and there's nothing I can do to fix it on my own. You can try, you can butt your head against the wall, but I can tell you all of the churchy things that you might be trying, like quit cussing, or quit smoking, or quit drinking, learning Sunday school quotes, coming to church every time it's open, getting your own little table here, getting your parking spot, and putting money in the box, won't earn you any salvation, and it won't earn you any righteousness. And you trick yourself into thinking that it does. And you might be able to give yourself a little more permission to get closer to God, or in your mind you think you are because you do those things, but that's not how it works. The Holy Spirit comes to you, convicts you of sin, and then once you've been convicted of that sin, you ask Jesus to come into your heart, and whenever the Holy Spirit comes to live there, then you are made a believer once and forever. Because it is a permanent transaction, it's not something that's going to be revoked later on because you messed it up, because truth of the matter is you never did anything to get to begin with. So you can't be snatched out of his hand. And it is something that's going to be stamped forever. And then from that moment forward, the believer becomes convicted of righteousness. You no longer are convicted of sin. And so don't come to this church and walk out the doors and say, man, I've been convicted that I need to start doing something better, because that's not how the Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit will convict you of more righteousness and for you to operate better in that righteousness. But he's not going to be convicting you of sin because you're not convicted of sin anymore. Because that's been removed. It's done. And so the Holy Spirit becomes our helper, because we need help to know what to do. We need help to know what to say. And he says that he's going to call to our remembrance everything that he said to you. Do you understand that the moment that you gave your heart to Jesus Christ, the entire Bible, every bit of this, got injected right into your heart? It's right there. And so you're going to hear things every now and then. You're going to hear things on the radio, and you're going to know things that you didn't know that you know whenever you hear them put into words. That's what grace does. You're going to hear things all the time, and you're going to go, man, I already knew that. I just didn't know how to say it. Because the word is there. Because you've got a whole lot more power than you agree that you have been operating in, because you didn't know it. Because you maybe have been taught over the years that you've got to earn a little bit more. Maybe you need to start getting things like this as a reward from God. No, that's already yours. The Holy Spirit is a helper. He's going to teach you what discernment is. Before you got saved, you had gut feelings. Now you have that same gut feeling, but you've been empowered by a very supernatural power inside of you, the Holy Spirit, that is going to teach you whenever things are right and things are wrong. You're going to know it upon contact. Discernment. You're going to know things that people's never told you. You're going to know things about other people that nobody's ever said. You're going to learn how to steer clear of things that you need to stay away from. You're going to learn how to be drawn to things that are good for you and your family. Help. The helper. It is going to help you to understand the intentions of the Father better than you were ever able to understand them in religion. You see, you have to operate in grace for this to work. Because if you're not operating in grace, you're going to resist this stuff. Because it's going to feel too good. It's going to feel like, oh, man, that's just too good to be true. And you've been taught that that's the way it is whenever it comes to the things with God. But in this case, it's not. This is going to happen in spite of your effort. This is available. What you have to do is learn how to accept it. So we have a teacher to remind us of what he said and to help us to say and do the right thing. How many of you have trouble praying? I'm going to raise my hand. Sometimes I don't know what to pray. Sometimes I just pray the same thing over and over again, and I don't even mean to. Sometimes maybe we just should depend on the Holy Spirit to do that for us, because Romans chapter 8 verse 26 shows us exactly how we do this. Now, we're talking about being in communion with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to tell you something that's probably going to come back to haunt me later on because somebody's going to misunderstand it, but I'm just going to tell you that the reward for one or two of you that gets it is going to be worth the backlash I get from the rest of you. Maybe you just need to stop praying. And so some of y'all are sharpening your knives right now. Now, I don't mean forever. I don't mean give up on it. I mean learn to put some more faith in prayer, and maybe you let the Holy Spirit do some praying for you. Maybe that's what I mean whenever I say you should quit praying. Maybe you should just be silent. Check this. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. We're still bound to this body of flesh. We still have some weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings that which cannot be uttered. So maybe you find yourself frustrated. Maybe you just think that your prayers haven't been answered like you think that they should be, or maybe they're not suiting you, or maybe it just seems like everybody else's prayers get answered and yours don't. How about you just take a little bit of time off? Again, I'm not saying quit or give up on prayer. I'm saying put more faith in prayer. You put more faith in prayer and let the Spirit do it for you. Sometimes the only prayer I can offer up is, Spirit, what do I need to pray? Because I can't do it alone. My prayers of the past has just been just big old long lists stamped out of things that I either need to take care of with God to kind of maybe reconcile myself on some repentance, wrong thinking, of course, or things that I wanted Him to take care of for other people for me that had health problems. That's been prayers. And then whenever those prayers don't get answered, first thought is, I've either messed this up or God's not who I thought He was. Again, lots of wrong thinking there. But whenever I go to a quiet place and I just seek the Spirit, sometimes I might not even know what the prayer is, but I just spend time alone with God in the prayer room, in the throne room that's outlined in the book of Revelation. I see myself sitting there, and I see the scepters in there singing, holy, 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 24 hours a day, and I go there, and I just let the Spirit pray. Whenever I get up and I leave there, then I say, it's done. The Spirit will pray for us. How about this? How about, have you ever wondered about if you're saved before? Because there's some scripture in the book of Matthew that says you're going to have to forgive others of your trespasses, or the Father's not going to forgive you. Has that ever scared anybody to death like it has me? Because I've got some strained relationships. people have done things to me that I have a hard time letting go of. And so sometimes I just completely give out and I collapse. And I get to thinking, I'm not going to grab a hold of heaven. I'm not going to heaven because I have a hard time letting go of some things. Here's the thing, I'm a man of principle. If you don't know that about me, maybe this is it. I'm telling you now. I have a real bad tendency because I believe people whenever they tell me something. And I believe that people have good intentions. Sometimes that doesn't work out in my favor. And whenever I've been lied to over and over again, there becomes a point where I become dumb. And I may not have any bad feelings towards you, but I just have to leave you over there, away from me, away from my family, so that I can have protection and I can have peace. Because if I've asked you to do something over and over again, and I keep getting lies, then... And so I struggle. Is that unforgiveness? And I get very worried and upset that maybe I'm not forgiving people the way that Jesus forgives them. Obviously I'm not. Because Jesus forgave us once and for all, period. In spite of all the bad stuff, in spite of all the stuff we don't want to talk about. So I'm not able to forgive like Jesus did. I'm not able to forgive every sin and every trespass that's been committed towards me and my family. And so I get real worried that sometimes my salvation is just going to be revoked because I'm not able to do that. But we go to, again, the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 16 and 17. And the Spirit bears witness that we are saved. So let me ask you about forgiveness that you have in your life, you know, and I'm admitting that it ain't good for me to hang on to stuff whenever people have committed sins towards me. And I know it's not good. But if I was able to uphold the 613 laws or even the 10 commandments, would I be in need of grace? Now, I'm not abusing it. Don't take this wrong. I'm just here to tell you that grace has to do for me what I can't do for myself. I'm here to tell you that grace is my only hope. And I'm here to tell you that I want to forgive. And that I want to let go of things. But maybe it's just not the time yet. Maybe I haven't worked all the way through it. I don't know. But I've had to resolve that I am saved. And I've had to resolve that it's once and for all because the Spirit bears witness that I am. I understand the intentions of the Father's heart. I understand the intentions of the Father's heart working in me that I know that I need to forgive people, and I'm working my way through that if not give up on it. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. See, I don't ever want anybody to walk in here and to walk out those back doors wondering if they're saved, because you get nothing but judgment and condemnation from up here. You just won't do that here. I'm not going to stand up here and yell and spit and scream at you for all the ways that you've messed up over the week. In fact, I'd rather put the spotlight on me and show you how I've messed up, and maybe you can find some of your situation in that. If we're children, then we're heirs. Heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with Him, that we might be glorified together. If the Spirit has convicted you of sin, and you've learned what repentance is, and repentance is not a confession or a list of things that you give to God every night before you go to sleep. Repentance is seeing the error of your ways and agreeing with God's heart. Agreeing with the intentions of God and what all of this love and all of this is about. That's what repentance is. Because before, we did not agree with the way God saw things. The only thing we could do is agree with the way we see things and the way the world sees things. And so, maybe seeing the error of our ways and seeing the ways in which we need help and seeing our weaknesses and seeing that we have been made right before God in spite of all those things is the proof that we need that we are His. If every single one of us was perfect, then there would be no need for church. If every single one of us was perfect, then the community out there would be just right. There wouldn't be any hurt. There wouldn't be any mental health crisis like we're in out there. There wouldn't be any diseases because there would be no sin. Before Adam and Eve sinned there in the garden, there was no sickness. It had not entered the world yet. I need you to understand that if you have accepted Jesus into your heart and allowed the Spirit to live inside of you, then the Spirit says you are His forever. So I'm going to ask again this in closing. Are you in communion with the Holy Spirit? There's just three things that we've touched on today. There's at least 10 characteristics and things that the Holy Spirit does for us. These three that I really wanted to touch on with you today. So, are you in communion with the Holy Spirit? And if your answer was no before you got here, that's great. Because you can walk out of here with that answer being yes. Just by accepting the fact that He is going to do it for you. And that you can just enjoy that glory. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Your Holy Spirit is more than we can comprehend sometimes. And that's why we're going to have to break it down into these little bites like we've got here today. Lord, we just thank You for these three things. But God, we just want to thank You for loving us the way that You do. You proved it through Your Son, Jesus Christ. We get to enjoy His grace every single day. Now, we're doing some things inadvertently, on accident, that's treading on His grace. But He knew that we would, and He gave it to us anyway. Thank You for bringing to our remembrance of things that we might be doing wrong, or things that we might do to cheapen Your grace. And Father, the gratitude that we have in our heart for our salvation will help us to overcome those. To help us to repent of those things and to move forward. But Lord, right now we just want to thank You for Your Holy Spirit. We want to thank You for making our heart perfect at the time of salvation, putting Your entire Word into it, and bringing to our remembrance everything that we need to operate efficiently in this relationship with You. Lord, we just want to thank You that we're not lacking anything. Any strength that we may bring to the table as far as serving our family, our church, or our community, God, that is just a gift directly from You. We didn't earn it. You just gave it to us. So Father, we just thank You for these strengths that we have that might be able to point other people to the cross. We want to thank You for this time that we get to spend every week joining together with other believers. Just bragging on how good Your grace is. So Lord, we just want to thank You for the Holy Spirit that lives in us. It's in Your name we pray. Amen.
Oh,